So the 1928 schooner AJ MEERWALD is spending this winter and spring in Belfast undergoing a restoration under Clark and Eisele. Tonight, we're going to find out more about the project, and I will have hand it over to Rachel and then Tim.
Hi, everybody. Thank you, Gina. My name is Rachel Dolhansick. I'm the museum curator at the Bay Shore Center at Bivalve. We're located in Bivalve, New Jersey, which, as we like to say, is in South Jersey, right near the right off the Delaware Bay. If you're familiar with New Jersey, we're not too far from Cape May and down that neck of the woods, but like right along the bay. We are a environmental history museum. With a mission to advance the understanding of the human impact on the environment. And we do this through our schooner, the AJ Meerwald, through our museum, the Delaware Bay Museum, and then also through programs and events. So what I'm going to do to start off is first give a little quick overview about where we're located. I'm going to use Google 360 to do that. Then we have a 12-minute orientation video that will give you a really nice understanding about the history that the AJ Meerwald comes from, about the Delaware Bay oyster industry, and about the characters and the boats and everything else that made that together. Excuse me. And then I do have a couple of slides to show you about what the boat looked like over the years, and then I'll turn it over to Tim, who will talk about the restoration. So to begin, let's see. So here you are on the deck of the AJ Meerwald. This is the Morris River. And if you were to go out to the horizon here, that's the Delaware Bay right out there. As you can see, there's a couple of oyster boats that are passing by. This one's definitely an old former schooner. There's still about 10 or so that still operate today. So if you were to come to Bivalve, this is where you would come to on our home port, right here at the oyster shipping sheds. So here, and you can go to our website, bayshorecenter.org, and click on museum, and then there's all these kind of virtual things. There's another old schooner over here too. So the cool thing about Bivalve, it is still a working waterfront in the middle of the marshes, again on the Morris River, which is a National Wild and Scenic Designated River. Let me see, how do I get off the boat here? So if you were to come this way, these are the oyster shipping sheds. They were built in 1904 by the Central Railroad Company in New Jersey, with the sole purpose of packing and shipping oysters. So you had hundreds of these schooners that, of course, and you'll see in the video too, they would, plant and then harvest the oysters. There was an entire process. I'm not going to get into too much detail today, but the last step, well, the second to last step is that the oysters were put onto these flat bottom boats, which came into the wharves here. And this is where they would pack up the oysters and put them into sacks or barrels and then get them ready to send out via the railroad. So they would go up these alleyways that were throughout the building. You can see here that our decks are flooded. We do flood about 7 days every month due to the rising waters and erosion that is happening. So, from what I understand, when this building was built, it was originally a foot above the highest high tide. So, not the case anymore. This is where we have our programming. We will have like live music out here and do kids' activities, all sorts of things. So, it's a really cool facility. And if you come up the alleyway, this is the loading dock. We have one boxcar here that represents all the cars, all the train cars that used to line up right along here, where there was two tracks where they would load in the oysters and then ship them all over the country. At that time, it was in the early 20th century, it was all the shell trade. So they kept the oyster meat in the shell and they did not shuck it. That came later in the 20s. So oystermen would lease from the railroad units like you see here. And so, for instance, Bradford here would lease this corner unit, and that would give him access to the water and then access to the railroad for shipping out the oysters. And these would have stretched all the way down. So I'll just do a quick little peek into our museum. We have several different areas and rooms. So hopefully this will entice you to take a vacation down our way sometime. Here's this really beautiful mural of the AJ Meerwald in East Point Lighthouse, which is right at the mouth of the river. And you can take a peek in here. The exhibit on the left is all about recreation along the area. And the exhibit over here to the right is about the time period of shucking oysters, the community of Shell Pile, about the African-American migrant workers who came to the area to work in the shucking houses. And it's all based on oral history interviews. So let me go back out the door. And I'll just go out this way just so you can see a little bit better. So you can see how long the building, and there was originally 30 units that were rented, leased from the railroad. And even like the front door that we just went through, that would have been an alleyway as well. So that pattern continued all the way down. All right, so that's a really quick tour of our building. And again, there's other exhibits, and you can go to our website, bayshorecenter.org, click on museum information, and then you'll see these 360s here. All right. So now what I want to do is show you our orientation video that we showed our patrons who come to our site. And this you can find on YouTube. Let me slide this out of the way here. It's called Changing Tides, and it will give you a really good sense of the area that the AJ Meerwald comes from and about the type of boat she is, where she falls into the history. So.
Fantastic. It was a sight to be seen.
It wasn't just a way of earning a living. It was so embedded in the families and in the lifestyle and in the community.
The smell of the river, that's something that'll live on you forever.
We were farmers. Yeah, we produced a product.
Thanksgiving and Christmas, I don't think we ever took them off.
We have an incredible legacy here and oyster families that built so much.
They were real business people, you know.
Just takes you back to your childhood and how blessed you were.
I loved it.
Yeah, I loved it. Like I say, you had no headaches out there.
It was quite a time.
We worked hard and played hard and lived a beautiful life.
What's interesting, I guess, in historical perspective, is how folks in the Delaware Bay decided to embrace oyster planting and embrace it as enthusiastically as they did.
Spring bay season, bringing them down, planting them, and then in the wintertime, dredging them up and selling them. So you had to catch it twice to sell it once.
You went up the bay May and June. You overhauled your boats over the summer. And beginning September, people start to harvest.
Similar to farming, you hope for the best, but it doesn't turn out that way a lot of times.
We dredged off the natural beds for the seed and planted it on our own bottom, and then in the wintertime dredged off of our own bottom.
And you had to get in every day that you could. I mean, you only had so many days.
When you started, you'd do pretty good, and towards the end of the season, it would slack up.
And that was your money for the year. You would plant them on your ground. If you didn't do good up the bay, you wasn't going to do good in the winter.
But you were not in a hurry in the wintertime like you were in the spring. Because it's up there, so you got to get all the seed you can get.
Our crews, they come up from Maryland.
When Dad needed the crew, he would send the word out down there, and he would hire as many Eastern shoremen as he could.
Because they were good oystermen, they were tongers, they all knew how to handle oysters.
They would come here and they would stay here, like you say, the whole week. Stay on the boat overnight, every night, and eat on the boat.
They came here to work. They wouldn't go back every week. They would send their money home, and they would stay once at a time.
Separate the shells from the oysters was a primary job.
2, 6,
heave.
Their secondary job was to handle the sails and reef when the captain wanted them reefed. They used to ring a bell. You'd heave one ding, you'd heave the lee, I think, and two dings, you'd heave the winter dredge.
So I tell people I'm a farmer, and I plow all the time, but I can't see my plow.
It's really almost like choreography to know how long to leave the dredge in, when to start the next one.
Yeah, there is a little finesse to it. I mean, you're turning, the time you want to wind, it's up here, and it's just there.
You get a feel for it.
I'm guessing, but I would say you ought to be moving about a walk to dredge. And that's the way they controlled the speed when they were dredging. If they were going too fast, you took a reef. And if you weren't going fast enough, you'd let it shake it out.
A coming up of the dredge over the side is the time when the people have to start getting engaged and manhandling it.
Two guys on each side of the dredge, and we're taking and dump it. Then we get down on our knees and had the wire baskets, and we'll pick them up and put them in the basket.
There's a moment where you kind of have a sense of whether it's a good haul or whether it's mostly shell.
And some would be single, then some would be all hooked together. You had to use a hammer to knock them loose before you put them in the basket.
An oyster boat, to be satisfactory, had to be shallow. Because of operating around Delaware Bay, you know, to get in and out of Marsh River, if you were over 6 feet, you were too deep. They had to have a lot of deck space because you carried your oysters on deck.
It's just kind of neat to think that boat was around before the Civil War. The cashier was here that whole time, and she had a following. You know, she was known. She was somebody. She was a vessel that had a legacy.
The old oyster boats, which had a clipper type bow with hollow water lines, that's the original oyster boat. Then about, I don't know, 1925 or somewhere in there, they started building a spoon bow boat, which the Meerwald is a spoon bow boat. And they were faster, bigger.
Designed to be easily operated by just a few people. And, you know, so that gave more time to be sorting oysters and doing the other work. I think it's a great design boat. And for a boat that was designed for the Delaware Bay, you know, I find it, you know, we've had it out in the ocean a number of times. Nothing like super scary weather, but its motion is very nice.
Yes. The good stuff.
Yeah, we all had cooks on the boat. Most of them were pretty good.
The cook was a valuable man.
You had eggs for breakfast every morning, and a thing that I've never had since that we always had on the boat for breakfast was fried bologna.
Fried bologna sandwiches. They were hot.
They always had fried bologna.
Baked beans with the hot dog, fried chicken with the fried pork chops.
One of the good things was the skipper always ate first.
Sometimes you can smell the food all across the water. It smells so good.
I always hated the fog in the wintertime when the decks got iced up. Very dangerous.
The river was froze over, and they would use dynamite to break the ice. And then even after they broke the ice, one boat would have to cut through to make the path because there were so large chunks.
So we had to have the oysters for Christmas. And I went out there by myself, should have known better. And I stepped down on the deck, boy, I took one and broke my arm out there. But I got the oysters.
He left that morning on his boat. He left our house with money on the table for our school lunches, as he always did. And he left, and he didn't come back anymore.
Things started to change during the Second World War.
The biggest change was to change from sail to power. No question about that.
Boats went to power, dredging and on the seed beds, and there was a lot of changes that took place on up through, to, including the 70s, when actually, you know, most of all the crews were done away with.
They had to do it. You just couldn't get people to handle sailboats and do the things that had to be done to make them go. Luther Jeffries and I got an idea that we would try to figure out a way to call oysters automatically without the crew. And he came up to the shipyard and talked about it. I said, well, we'll build a test model. It was a little cage like you see on these that we turned by hand, and I was shocked. The oysters came out one way and the shells came out the other. I couldn't hardly believe it.
At about the same time, George had the idea, if you have real thin shell, that shell's going to fall through to the bottom part of it. Good oysters will stay on the upper part of it. It would go from a plain conveyor up to the calling machine now, and then on into that, and then it come up over onto another conveyor and load the boat. It saved a lot of time.
I guess due to the way that the industry has changed, again, a lot of them have went back to the hand calling, non-mechanized dredging, like more so back in the old days. You know, we switched over in the middle 90s to a quota system after MSX and Dermo, and that, you know, we had to change the way the fishery was managed.
'57 and then '58 and '59 were very, very high mortality years. They lost up to 90% of the oysters down in the lease beds and up to 50 to 70% on the seed beds, which are now where the fishery operates. Right around the time when it was looking like there was going to be massive success and MSX resistance was here and the oysters can come back and be healthy, Dermo moved in. And it's this other disease. It's very similar in that it's a single-celled parasitic organism that kills oysters, but it's different in the sense that the oysters, for some reason, are not becoming resistant.
We're doing all right. I mean, we got a good product. We're getting the notability that we deserve, I think, and you know, people are asking for Jersey oysters, and it's all good despite the challenges.
I think it's important not just nostalgically to look back and say how it was, but in order to take care of and preserve and be good stewards of what's here today, it really helps to recognize the history and to be respectful of the things that were in the past.
the history of what's gone on and the ability for me as an ecologist to be able to touch back to that history is invaluable.
Hoping that people, you know, get out in the water and see the beauty of being out there and, you know, connect to our area, maybe take that drive down to Bivalve and come and visit.
Before I turn it over to Tim, I'm just going to show you a couple of quick slides here. Okay. So now that you see where the AJ Meerwald lives and you learn a little bit about the Delaware Bay oyster industry, or at least the New Jersey side of the Delaware Bay oyster industry, I'm just going to show you a couple slides about the AJ Meerwald over the years. So before I do that, I will plug our new book that we have out, The AJ Meerwald in New Jersey's Oyster Industry. It's a really great look at the history and has about 120 photographs in it. So I do encourage you, if you're interested, to check it out. There was a link I saw in the information that went out to you from your museum. And you can also go to our website and order it through there. Oh, and I will say, we do call ourselves the oyster capital of the world. That's been something kind of folklore, but it's been part of the saying for a long, long time. So really quick geography lesson. Here's the state of New Jersey. I know some of you are potentially from New Jersey or have family from this area. This is Cape May County down here, Cape May down at the end, Atlantic City's over here. Here we are in Cumberland County. So this is the Delaware Bay, goes on up to the Delaware River, which forms the western side of the state, goes on up past Wilmington, Delaware, Philadelphia, on up to Trenton, and points north. So the area that we're looking at is right about here, and that's what you see here on the larger map. So here we are in Bivalve. Here's the Morris River, and there's other communities, some which don't really exist anymore, but we still put them on the map. This is actually from the book that talks about all the various places. But when they were talking about harvesting the oysters, that was up here in the seabeds off of Fortescue. Right now, the fishery mainly operates out of Money Island because they can go direct to the seabeds and harvest that way. Traditionally, though, that bay season, that springtime period, is when they would plant the oysters out here in the Morris River Cove, because there was higher salinity, warmer water, the oysters grew faster, and it was, you know, very controlled. So that's a really quick geography lesson. So the AJ Meerwald, built in 1928. As was said in the film, she was a new style oyster schooner. They were built in the mid to late 20s because things were great. There had been a large set of oysters around 27. So there were just millions and millions of oysters out there. Things were good. The AJ Meerwald, in case you're wondering, is named for Augustus Joseph Meerwald. He was the dad of these two guys right here. This is Augustus C., also known as Gus, and his brother Bill, William. And it was their dad who had also had several boats himself, who was working the oyster industry. So they followed in his footsteps. They were two of, I think 10 children, eight children in the family. And their grandfather, who's this man here, was Augustus Sr. He actually came to the area from Prussia originally, and he also worked the maritime trades. So that's a really quick lesson on the Meerwald family. But they settled in South Dennis, which, if I go back to this slide, is over here in Cape May County. And they sold oysters to opposite bivalve in Morris River Village. So when I was originally showing you that 360 tour, you would look across the marsh, and there was originally another railroad over there and other shucking houses and so forth. So the Meerwalds operate the boat for about a period of 5 years. Then you end up in the 1930s, the Depression, things aren't going too well. So that's when the boat takes on a new life for about 5 years, when she's used by the U.S. Coast Guard and is renamed 86001-F. And she is a fireboat, and she operates between Camden, New Jersey, and Philadelphia, helping watch over the port during the war years, taking care of any fires or other issues that might arise. So this is what she looked like. As you can see, very different. You can still see her shape, but outfitted with water cannons, and her masts are gone. She now has a pilot house there. So quite different. Now originally, in my thought was that there was only about three boats from our area that went and went to the War Commission and worked, during those war years. My thought is the Meerwalds were looking for an opportunity to still have their boat working and take in some money, but there was an issue back and forth between the government and the Meerwald family about how much the boat was worth. And so the government ended up having the boat until 1947, which was, of course, 2 years after the war because of this whole back and forth. But the Meerwalds had friends in high places. And I'm just gonna read you really, really quickly this letter from a senator who writes to my dear Admiral, and this is actually 1943. And he says, "Several of my very close friends have brought to my attention the apparent discrepancy in the offer which has been made by the War Shipping Administration and the computed value of the vessel, the AJ Meerwald, requisitioned June 1st, 1942, which has been the subject of correspondence between your administration and representatives of the owners of the vessel for some time." So he, encourages to, let's have a reasonable compromise. But this was 42, it'd be until 47 until that was finally reached. And at that point, the boat was returned as is where is. So the last time the Meerwald saw the vessel, it looked like this. And then when they went to go retrieve it, it looked like this. And this was actually taken by the son-in-law of Gus Meerwald. He's in his 90s now, still living in California. So it's pretty neat. So then we get to 1947, and now we're gonna meet Clyde A. Phillips. And this is the boat from 1947 to about 1957. The man here, I don't know if is that hiding it? Yes, here we go. This is Clyde A. Phillips here. He was an oysterman. He owned several vessels. He also owned a shucking house. He was quite well known in the area. He was also a union organizer. He helped unionize the shuckers and the others that were working the fishing industry, and just a really respected man. And I was going to read something quick, but I don't think I can find it now. But in any event, he passes away the night before the harvest season opens. And that's when they found out that MSX, that parasite, had wiped out almost all of the planted oysters. So his son told me, though, that his dad had actually earlier that year taken out a loan for $750,000 to expand his business. And that was, unfortunately, he passed away. And his son, who's also Clyde A. Phillips, decided not to take on the business because he didn't want to start his career being so much in debt. All right. So the boat, again, oysters under power for about a period of 10 years. In 1957, she's converted to clam oysters to work offshore, off the ocean. So a metal sheathing is applied to her hull. I believe it adds something like 10 tons of weight to that. Of course, the sailing years are long since over. And she clams off and on until the 1970s. And at that point, she's really just bought and sold. Here come my cats walking across the way here. She's just bought and sold to really for her license at that point. So in 1986, it's owned by a man named Donnie McDaniels. And he just buys her for her license. At that point, the boat's in Salisbury, Maryland. And this man right here, John Gandy, who lives up in Maine now and has volunteered to help with coordinating this project, he keeps pestering Donnie. And he, you know, he's heard about this boat, and I want to read this really quick if I find it. So I had all my pages marked here, and then, okay, here it goes. So it's 1986, and John Gandy saying, I say, Donnie, what are you going to do with that old oyster boat? I always had an idea how great it would be under sail. The local Dorchester shipyard had hauled out 100-foot schooner recently, and the schooner's launch had impressed him. And he says, I was just kind of joking with Donnie. Finally, we were walking along, and I brought it up again. He said, John, you want it that bad? Make me an offer I couldn't refuse. $1, sight unseen. Then I thought, holy cow, what am I going to do? This was the Clyde A. Phillips. I didn't know Clyde at the time, but I knew she'd be built in Dorchester, so I knew what kind of boat she'd be. So the next 2 years, John and his son, Nathan, go down to Salisbury and sort of tinker and caulk and try to do something. So it isn't until 1988 when the boat is brought back home to bivalve. Actually, this man right here is Clyde A. Phillips Jr., signing the first check to become a member. And this here is Megan Wren, who would be our founder and original executive director. So this, again, is 1988. She's not in the best of shape. It isn't until about 1993 that enough money and grant funds are received to bring on professional shipwrights. Prior to that, but even during the time period of the professional shipwrights, a lot of volunteers help out. There's still a number of old timers around, like John Du Bois right here, who remember working on the boats under sail. They worked in the shipyard. So there was a lot of knowledge from the old timers to restore the boat back and to be as authentic as possible. So here's just a couple of pictures. This man here, Mort Hughes, he was another old timer from Cape May. And he shows up in his Winnebago one Saturday. And at the time, the volunteers were desperate to remove some of the weight from the ship, all the steel mast, the clam rig, the boat, it was just, the seams were struggling. It was sinking. She was sinking. And it says, Mort, the owner of the Winnebago, finally spoke up. And he said, you don't need money. Just get a ladder, a cutting torch, some chain, a shackle, and a few strong backs. And so that's how they got the all that metal off. And it turned out that Mort had actually installed the steel mast and the other metal working back back in the early days of clamming. So again, it was really a good time to do the first restoration. And I'm sure Tim and Garrett would have loved to meet some of these guys. There's Megan again, caulking early before the shipwrights were hired. And then the ship was launched in 1995, and we became New Jersey's official tall ship in 1988. But that's just the title. There's no funding that goes with it. Here's a picture here of, at the time, Governor Whitman naming her the official tall ship. So just a quick couple of pictures and I'll turn it over to Tim. We do public sales. We do educational sales. Of course, education both on the boat and also on shore at our facility at the shipping sheds, both environmental and history programs. You saw those pictures already from our tour. And of course, we have our special events like Second Fridays and various festivals. It seems like we always have oysters and beer and wine and other food as, you know, part of our programs. So a lot going on during the season. And consider coming for a sail with us sometime. Once we are back up and operating, we do sail around the state to various ports around New Jersey. But again, consider coming down to Bivalve sometime, and I think you definitely would enjoy it. So with that, I'm gonna turn it over to Tim. And he will tell you what's going on now that you have all this background and information.
Hey, can you hear me? All right. Let me just get my slides up on the screen. So my name is Tim Clark, and I am a co-owner of a company called Clark and Eisele Traditional Boat Building. We're based here in Maine. And my partner Garrett Eisele and I met with Bayshore Center, I think in 2018. They had reached out and were looking for shipwrights to sort of assess the current state of the vessel and think about any future, near future work that might need to be done. So we traveled down to New Jersey and we took a look at the boat, and we did a pretty thorough report, basically outlining all of the issues that we saw and all of the things that we thought the boat might need within the next couple of years. And based on that assessment, Bayshore Center decided to begin fundraising to actually move ahead with a pretty thorough restoration job. So the boat being 25 or so years out of her first restoration, obviously has seen has done quite a lot of sailing and has seen a lot of wear and tear. So, you know, that's about the typical time frame that you would start to see the sort of wear and tear on these kinds of boats that would warrant, pretty thorough restoration work. So we made a plan to bring the boat up here to Maine and set up sort of a temporary shipyard and give the boat the attention that she needs. So the plan was to start the rebuild last summer. And in this first photo, this is a picture of a large plastic bowshed that we have at our property where we stored a lot of the lumber as we prepared for the restoration job. And what you see in this picture is all of the decking for the Meerwald. So that's all Alaskan yellow cedar is what we chose to use for the deck. And we stacked all the deck planking into our bowshed, and we began very long process of painting the bottom of all the deck planks. So we gave it two coats of primer and a top coat. And the idea is that when we lay the deck, somebody can just go below and do one more coat of paint overhead, and that saves having to do multiple coats overhead, which is a real pain in the neck. And this way you also have paint on both the tops of the beams and the underside of the decking. So all the mating surface is where a lot of problems arise with leaking decks and water, standing water between deck, the deck and the deck frame would cause rot issues. So that was the choice we made, was to paint the decking first. And that was the very first thing we did this summer. So this was in August. And then the boat was scheduled to arrive in September. I have quite a few photos here, so I'm gonna probably zip through many of them. So I apologize if I don't keep a photo up for as long as you'd like, but I've got a lot to get through here. So, okay, so this first photo is a picture of me and my wife out in my my oyster skiff, coincidentally enough, that I built for myself a few years ago. We trailered it up to Brooklyn, Maine to meet the Meerwald when she arrived. We thought it would be fun to launch our boats up there. So that's in the background. That's my partner, Garrett, with his Bahama dinghy. So we converged in the bay, and all of the main wind jammers came together to welcome the Meerwald when she showed up. And we had an absolutely fantastic day. The weather was beautiful. The sailing was great. All the boats were there. And one of the main reasons why we chose to have the Meerwald come up to Brooklyn and sail into Wooden Boat Harbor was to meet up with the J&E Riggin, which you can see here. And she is nearly a sister ship to the Meerwald, both built in the same shipyard on the Morris River, 2 years apart. The J&E Riggin, of course, many of you know, operates as a windjammer up here in Maine, a passenger vessel that takes people out for week-long excursions. And this was the first time that the Meerwald and the Riggin had been in each other's company for God knows how long, probably since the 1930s or so. Maybe Rachel can pinpoint that more accurately. But it was really great to see the boats sailing together. Meerwald came into Wooden Boat Harbor and anchored amongst the other schooners. And we had a great time sailing around. And these pictures here are the Meerwald and the Riggin sailing together. You can see how similar the two boats are. And just a couple shots of all the windjammers gathered together, anchored in the harbor. So a couple days later, the Meerwald showed up at Front Street Shipyard in Belfast, where they tied up alongside, and the crew downrigged the vessel, and we pulled the masts out with a crane, stripped everything off the boat. And then the boat was hauled out in Front Street Shipyard's travel lift slip. Oh, I apologize. This seems to be out of order. So there's the crane pulling the masts out. And in this picture, the windlass is coming off. So you can see she's quite stripped down there. And then all the spars were moved over to a location next to the temporary shed where we are currently doing the restoration. And there's the Meerwald's crew there carrying some of the spars over. This picture here is, this is actually parts for the trailer that moved the Meerwald to the restoration spot. So this is a company called Brownell Systems out of Massachusetts that specialize in moving very large boats. So they trucked up all the pieces to assemble the trailer underneath the Meerwald while she was in the travel lift, and boat gets set down onto the trailer and is very slowly and methodically moved a couple hundred yards or so over to where we're currently doing the work. In this picture, the rudder is being removed so that we could strip all the hardware off. All of the stainless steel hardware below the waterline is going to be replaced. And there's the boat being set down onto the trailer. This picture gives a pretty good representation of the size of the Meerwald. So here she is sitting in the spot where we're doing the work, next to Front Street Shipyard's main building. This is actually on a town lot that is owned by the town of Belfast, which we are leasing. And on the ground there, you can see the walls for our temporary structure. So I'll zip through these pictures pretty quick. You can see our temporary restoration shed going up. We brought in a crane to set down some manufactured trusses. And then we shrink wrapped the whole building. So once we got the shed set up with all of our tools and equipment, we built some staging around the boat, and the process of demolition began. So this was the very first thing we did, was tear off the rub rails. And here you can see the bulwarks being cut off. Now, one thing that's always challenging with these projects is the amount of documentation that has to be done. And in addition to taking just as many photos as you possibly can, you have to take as many notes as you can about where things go and how they look and what the dimensions are and all of that information. And inevitably, no matter how much you write, and no matter how many pictures you take, you're always going to forget stuff. So you can't take too many pictures and you can't take too many notes. But so far, we're doing a pretty good job, I think. So in this picture, you can see where we've taken some of the cap rail apart on the bulwarks. And to the layperson, if you were to look at the Meerwald before the restoration began, you might think, oh, she doesn't look so bad. It's really when you start poking around and really, you know, looking for signs of deterioration and water ingress that you really start to get a clear picture of what kind of shape the boat's in. And you can see things like the wood checking and the paint bubbling, and there are signs that are not so obvious to the average person. But as you can see, once you take these pieces of wood apart, then it becomes clear that, you know, whatever signs that you were seeing proved to be true, because you can see that there's quite a bit of rot there. And here we have in the covering boards where we've stripped the paint away, you could see where two covering boards butted together, where there's quite a bit of rot. So basically everywhere on deck that we were taking mating pieces of wood apart, we were finding signs of water ingress and the beginnings of deterioration. So here we are demolishing the deck. And all of the spikes that you see sticking up all had to be individually removed, pried out with giant pry bars and all kinds of crazy inventive tools that we had to come up with to do this job. That right there is Garrett Eisele, my business partner, and he's assessing the condition of the bow there. One of the things that we had planned for was to replace the starboard night heads. The night heads are those timbers that you see sticking up with that pipe going through them. That's the hawse pipe where the anchor chain runs through, and the night heads are there to sort of beef up the strength of the bow and give the anchor chain a really strong point to run through. And you can see the deterioration in those timbers in the night heads there. This is a picture of the aft cabin. And as I understand it, the aft cabin was preserved during the last restoration. It's one of the few things on the boat that was actually able to be preserved and reused. The vast majority of the Meerwald's timbers were replaced in the first restoration. And the cabin trunk for the aft cabin is original. It wasn't in the best of shape when it went back on the boat in the 1990s. And it was in completely unsalvageable shape this time around. But we had a discussion with the folks at Bayshore Center, and you know, there's a lot of there was a strong sentiment to try to save as much of the interior wood as possible, as that is all original. So we came up with a plan to carefully remove all of the V-match, all the vertical staving that you see on the bulkhead and the sides of the cabin trunk on the inside there. And we painstakingly took all those panels out and labeled them. And we're going to put it all back in as best we can. We've also saved those overhead beams. And we're going to have to do some restorative work on those to make them structurally sound again. And then we'll reuse those as well. Unfortunately, the decking on the top of the cabin trunk is not salvageable. So that was quite rotten and quite worn from years and years of re-caulking. So that had to go. But what we're going to do is replace it in kind with the same species of wood that was on there before, which was native Atlantic cedar. And we're going to stain it to match the rest of the interior. So with a little luck and a little skill, we could maybe make the inside of the cabin look like it had never been messed with. So here's one of our shipwrights after all of that staving has been removed, taking apart the aft cabin. And there's the top coming off. So in this picture, what you see are layers of wood that are laminated together with epoxy on top of an existing deck beam. So there were several deck beams on the boat that we had to replace completely. You can see the old beams on either side in this photo, where there are fastener holes and blown out bits of wood and little rot spots and things like that. And all of that had to be gone over, holes filled, graving pieces, rotten sections, chiseled out, sawn out, graving pieces glued in wherever necessary. Some beams were mostly kept intact, but had new ends scarfed onto them. So we just had to make decisions about which pieces of the deck frame could stay and which had to be either repaired or replaced entirely. So what you see in this picture with the laminations is we're stack laminating new deck beams. The old beams, the existing beams that you see there, were all solid timbers that were sawn to shape. So what that means is that they're a consistent thickness in the fore and aft orientation, but in the other orientation, they have curves sawn into them. So a more modern way of doing that is to take thinner pieces of wood and laminate them together over a form with the correct amount of curvature, which will then give you a new deck beam that is bent and glued to the correct shape rather than sawn out of a straight grained piece of wood. So that's the method we chose for all the beams we're replacing. And rather than build a form with the correct camber or curve in it, we just chose to put some plastic sheeting over an existing beam in the boat and just use that as our form to get the correct curve. And here's a couple of Carlins laminated. Carlins are the fore and aft oriented pieces of the deck frame that span between beams and have things like deck structures built on top of them wherever there's openings in the deck. In this photo, you can see one of our shipwrights doing some repair work on what are called the bulwark stanchions. And the stanchions are essentially frames that stick up through the deck and create the structural component of the bulwarks or the rails on the side of the boat. Many of the stanchions were fine. We didn't have to do anything with them. The vast majority of them were still mostly sound, but quite a few of them started to develop some rot at the deck level. And replacing all of those stanchions would have been a pretty intense operation. It would involve removing quite a bit of hull planking from the boat. So rather than do that, we opted to repair several of them. And the repair that he's doing here is about the most extreme type of repair that we did on the stanchions. Most of the stanchions just had little sections of rot that we were able to carve out and glue a graving piece onto. And some of them had quite a bit of rot. And if we wound up needing to take off, any more than half of the thickness of the timber, then we would just replace it entirely. So some of them we had to take off a few more strakes of planking than we ideally would have liked to. In other places, we were able to dig out the stanchions without disturbing the planking. And right there, you can see he's got a router set up so that in that last photo, he had a jig or a rail system sort of that the router could ride on so you could cut out a smooth an even portion of the timber to glue a new piece onto. So there they are all carved out. So in this picture, you can see a batten is clamped to the deck. And one of the things that we knew we had to deal with was straightening out the fairness of the deck the sort of the smooth and consistent shape of the curve of the deck. From the bow to the stern. And it was quite out of fare. There were some spots in the deck frame where there were broken beams. There were places where beams had checked and moved and dried out. So over time, the wood moves around. The boat loses its shape. And what you wind up with is a very unfair deck. So we take these long strips of wood or battens and we clamp them to the deck frame and try to get a sense of where the trouble spots are. And then the solution is to build the deck frame back up to where it needs to be with shims that are glued on. And that's what you can see in this photo. So we glued strips of wood onto the tops of the beams, wherever they may have been needed. And then we would go through and power plane the whole deck frame down, again, using these battens to check for fairness. It's a very painstaking, laborious process. In this picture, there's a new Samson post going into the boat. Samson post is the large timber that sticks up on the foredeck of the boat where the anchor windlass is fastened to. And there's Garrett working on the stern. Now, the biggest challenge with this project so far has been discovering just how bad the shape of the stern was. We weren't quite expecting that. We knew that there was some trouble back there. And over time, as we took more and more pieces apart, it became evident that we were looking at an entire rebuild of the transom. So at this point, she's stripped down. The back of the boat is stripped down to bare frames, and those are all being replaced. And here's Garrett working on one of the structural timbers in the on the transom. In this picture, you can see all the deck shims glued on. And we're pretty close, I think, to having it all fared and ready for deck planks. And you can also see around the deck openings where we've laid new grubs for the new cabin structures. And the grubs are basically the foundation of those structures. And here's the new night heads, all built and fastened in. So now you see in this picture, the first of the deck planking going down. Those are called the king planks. And the king planks are just thicker planks that are laid down the center line of the deck. And they are thicker so that they add a little bit more rigidity, a bit more structural support wherever the masts are stepped through the deck. So the thicker king planks were the first to go on. And about right about the same time, the new aft cabin started to come together. So here we see the sides of the aft cabin getting bolted down. And there's a shot again of the night heads. Quite a bit of planking had to come off, hull planking had to come off on the starboard side in order to expose those night head timbers. So all these battens that you see nailed on, after all the timbers have been replaced, you can see there's a couple of new bulwark stanchions up there in the bow as well. After all that stuff is done, we can go through and fair that portion as well. Same process as the deck, stretching battens over the frames and power planing wherever there's high spots and getting a nice smooth fair run to lay the planking over. So these battens that you see nailed on are for what is called lining off, which is the process of figuring out what the width of the hull planks needs to be. And of course, there's planking back aft out of frame that those battens run into. So we're running into existing planking. So you have to be careful to make sure that the lining off marks that you create actually work with the existing hull planking so that all of the seams run into each other smoothly and fairly. And here's another picture of some deck planking coming together, more king planks going in between the winder box and the galley the galley trunk. And there's the galley cabin trunk coming together there. There's the winder box again. So you might be wondering what that is. The winder box was a structure on the deck of dredge schooners that was essentially a little shelter for a mechanical dredge. There would have been a motor housed in that structure that would operate the oyster dredges. So that structure now acts just as a companionway. And I just threw this photo in to show you what one of our mornings looked like this winter. I think this particular day was a couple degrees below zero. Working in the shed has been pretty nice. If you remember, the plastic on the sides of the shed is white, but the plastic on the roof is clear. So on a sunny day, it actually warms up pretty well. But in the morning, especially on these days hovering around 0 degrees, it's pretty tough to go to work sometimes. Here's Garrett working on one of the topside planks, one of the hull planks. And that was a fun plank because it's one of three strakes of planking that are called whale strakes, and they're thicker than the rest of the hull planking. So they act as a little bit more, they give a little bit more structural support up at the waist of the boat, which is the portion of the hull, the top sides that meet the deck level. And on that third strake down, where it transitions back into the regular thickness planking, you have a nice bead detail along the bottom edge. So Garrett got to carve that bead, and it's always fun when you get to take out the hand planes and do some old-timey boat building work. And here we are back at the transom again. You can see that it's quite stripped apart. And the decision was made just about a week and a half ago to replace every one of those transom frames, those vertical frames that you see. And those are actually all now in place. We got that done in about a week. And here we see the aft cabin trunk, all the sides all stacked up and getting through bolted into the deck frame. Cabin structures coming together, deck planking going on. And here we have the first of the covering boards. And the covering boards are, as the name would suggest, wide boards that fit over the bulwark stanchions. And they give you a margin plank to run your deck planks up to. The bulwark stanchions have to be carefully patterned, and then the pattern is transferred to your covering board stock, where you draw the profile of each bulwark stanchion and cut each one out, and then the covering board has to be carefully fit down over those stanchions. And that's always a tricky job because they're hardly ever actually parallel to each other. Plus there you have the sweep of the deck, and you have all these different curves and different shapes that you have to accommodate. So it's a pretty painstaking process to fit these. And there you see the covering board going down over the stanchions and set in place. And I think I took this picture a couple days ago. So you see the new vertical transom frames going in. At one point in time, the transom had been worked on, and it looks like the tops of the, you can see there's transom frame timbers there that are painted with that orange paint, and you can see that it's top is cut off and that there's an additional timber bolted or sistered to the side of it. So at some point in time, the transom was worked on and those frames were were repaired by adding sisters to them. And we figured, well, we're in here, it's a good time to take those out and just replace them entirely with new wood. And this is about the point we're at now. I took these pictures this week, so we've got quite a bit of deck planking going on now. And another picture of the transom coming together. And there's the winder box all constructed. That just got its first coat of paint today. aft cabin coming together nicely. You can see there's new grubs in place for what is called the soft patch, which is a hatch on the top of the engine room that has a semi-removable top so that you can get the engine in and out. So you're actually looking at the forward portion of that cabin trunk is actually the engine room. So the aft cabin has a bulkhead dividing the engine room from the what you'd call, I guess, the main saloon or the aft cabin space where we saw all of the V-match staving that we're going to preserve. And that's it. That's where we're at as we speak.
So thank you all for joining us tonight. Thank you, Tim and Rachel, for presenting, and have a lovely evening.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye.